They announced Hayden yesterday.
Yeah, I know. I saw. I had the same reaction you did.
What, that I should tell him that we live in the same town?
That my friend lives in the same town as you do. That was literally my first thought.
I was like just going into work at the time, and I ended up mentioning to my coworker that Hayden was going, and she's like, "You haven't met Hayden?" That's kind of been everybody's reaction, where it's just like, "Wait, you seriously, you haven't?" And I'm wondering, since everybody else in town has met him, I'm wondering if he sees me in my Star Wars shirts and walks in the other
and runs
direction.
The other way.
Well, speaking of Anakin, let's talk about his wife.
Into the garbage, you fly boy!
This is a rebellion, isn't it?
I call it aggressive negotiations.
The garbage will do!
Welcome to this month's Trash Compactor podcast, Star Wars from a certain point of view. I'm Emcee and I'm here with...
Hi, I'm Sarah.
So this month we're doing an episode that we've been talking about basically as long as we've been doing Trash Compactor. We have a list of topics we want to discuss, and this has always been on there. And considering we've already talked about Leia and Rey, it makes sense that we should finally get to this character. We're going to be talking about Padme Amidala. I mean, I think probably one of the reasons why it's taken us so long to get to this is, and I mean, I'm not trying to sound mean, but none of us are terribly enamored of Padme.
Yeah, I don't dislike her, but she's definitely not one of my favorite characters.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's the way that I would word it, that, you know, I don't hate her, but I wouldn't say that she's nowhere near my top 10 or even my top 20. Every time I talk about Padme, it's not that I like her. I'm intrigued by her. She is an intriguing character to me. I've found her to be more mysterious than I'd say even Rey. Like, everybody's always like, oh, the mystery of Rey. But the mystery of Rey is all of the stuff around her. But I know who she is.
Right. We know so little about Padme. We know where she comes from. We know where she ends up. We know her story in the middle, but we don't know much about her as a person.
Exactly. Yeah. And she has affected so much in the Star Wars galaxy. TV Tropes has, one of their tropes is the unwitting instigator of doom. And that, I think, describes Padme perfectly.
That's a good description.
Yeah, because, I mean, really, if you look at the prequels, everything, I mean, it's the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Padme tries so many things that should be good, but ultimately ended up with where we start in A New Hope. She's the one who got Chancellor Palpatine into his position. She brought Jar Jar Binks into the Senate so that he was able to, like, do the whole thing so that Palpatine could get even more power. And then, of course, that's not even getting into all of the stuff with Anakin. And now it's not, I'm not saying this to, like, blame her because, you know, it's just how things went. But it's just interesting that she was kind of at the epicenter of all of this, but she's still very mysterious.
Right.
Yeah. We've only had, like, one book that has touched upon Luke or Leia's feelings about their mother, and that's in Bloodline. Leia does, and I guess a little bit in the Poe Dameron comic. At least Leia acknowledges that she has, am I right? That is the Poe Dameron comic where Leia has all of Padme's gowns?
Yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't remember because there's a lot of comics out there. But yeah, they've only really addressed anything regarding a bond between Padme and the twins with Leia, mostly through Bloodline, where she's thinking about how Padme has, you know, affected her even though she didn't know her. And honestly, I would like some more of that. I would like Luke's thoughts on a lot of things because we don't really have those right now.
Well, it kind of makes sense that Leia that it comes from Leia's perspective, because wasn't there a line that Leia remembers Padme very vaguely?
Yes, yeah. In Return of the Jedi, she remembers her mother.
Whether she actually does or not, since she was 2 minutes old.
Yeah. Apparently there is a scene where baby Leia looks at Padme, and that was supposed to be like the moment that Leia remembers.
Okay.
And people also use that as evidence that Leia is actually way stronger in the Force than Luke is.
I'm okay with that.
This month, or last month in March, we got, I'd say, probably the biggest bit of Padme-centric canon in the new EU. We had two things come out that were focused on her. We had Queen's Shadow by E.K. Johnson, which is a young adult book. And then we also had the Age of the Republic one-shot, Padme Amidala by Jodie Houser. Would you agree that these are like the biggest bits of canon we've had from focusing on Padme?
Absolutely. I mean, she was in Thrawn Alliances, but these are the most Padme-focused stories that we've gotten since she was introduced.
Yeah, I mean, at Thrawn Alliances, I am actually reading it at this current moment. But I'd say from what I've gathered from that, it's a lot more plot-driven. We don't get a lot of emotional growth from her. It's more she is an action character. Things are happening. She is doing things to set things in motion for Thrawn and Anakin. Meanwhile, with Queen's Shadow, it is all about Padme's growth as a character.
And the way she affects the people around her.
Yes. So I think probably we should talk about Queen's Shadow first, because that's the first chronologically. This is set 4 years after The Phantom Menace-ish.
Ish. It's right at the end of her reign as queen.
Yeah. Which, one thing I had not realized in The Phantom Menace is that she was, like, it was very early on in her queendom. I hadn't really, like, picked up on that, because why would I?
Yeah, I don't think there was anything to specify how far into her term it was.
Now, one thing that I would like to bring up, and this is one thing that is talked about a lot, and really in terms of people putting down The Phantom Menace, is the idea of an elected queen. For the last 25 years, and oh my god, it's been 25 years since The Phantom Menace.
20.
Yeah.
Don't make us older than we are.
Okay. Yeah, no, it's been 20 years since The Phantom Menace. And I've been trying to figure this out since that movie came out. The idea of an elected queen. And I think I finally figured it out. George Lucas really, really wanted to have a queen role in there. But he didn't want to put in the idea that Luke and Leia were actually royalty. Well, I mean, Leia is royalty. She's adoptive royalty. But then it adds in the whole idea of Luke, the secret prince. But by having her be elected, then it takes that away. It's like, no, she's just a politician.
Okay, I never thought about it like that.
But still, then it does introduce the whole can of worms of this young elected queen. And this is kind of a lot of what happens in Queen's Shadow. There's a lot about Padme's youth. It is something that people have been asking themselves for 20 years, is how the heck has this 14-year-old, like, function as a politician? Kind of in A New Hope, we didn't really see Leia do anything political, so we accepted that this 19-year-old could be a senator. But with the prequels, there's so much more politics in it, and we see Padme actually being political, that people started scratching their heads as to how this actually worked. Now, Queen Shadow actually kind of gets a lot more into that, and I feel like it's established in this that Naboo is just a planet of Doogie Howsers.
All right. Now, I may be misremembering. In fact, I probably am. But I never really saw the position of Queen as political as much as a figurehead. She was elected to, and if I could think of words, that would be great, to be a symbol.
Ceremonial?
Ceremonial, thank you. She didn't, the queen wasn't intended to make political decisions or have any impact on the galaxy as a whole.
Well, I think not on the galaxy as a whole, but she certainly has impact on Naboo because the queen is the one who was, like, signing treaties with the Trade Federation. And she does go to Coruscant and she makes the vote of no confidence.
But that was unexpected. And she didn't really have authority to do that, I don't think.
I've been trying to figure out galactic politics. And basically the way I've been trying to figure it out in my head is by shrinking it down. So instead of thinking of Naboo as a planet, thinking about it as a town. And that would basically make Padme the mayor. If that makes any sense.
Okay.
Because it does seem like the Republic kind of acts as, like, the federal government, and then things kind of slim down. And we do have, like, a governor of most of these planets. And so, yeah, I think I like to think of Padme as, like, the mayor of Naboo.
All right. All right.
Which sounds bad. Which now I'm thinking of, for any of our listeners who watch Parks and Rec, now I'm thinking of Padme as Ben Wyatt from Parks and Rec. But Queen Shadow is at the end of her term as queen and is the transition into her becoming senator. And we start to see this is the change of her from the Phantom Menace to Attack of the Clones. It's just about halfway between the two movies. It's her kind of brushing off everything that happened in The Phantom Menace and growing into that character that is very comfortable in the Senate and is very established as a politician. But this is her being very green and trying to figure out where she belongs on the galactic stage. To start out with, I loved this book. I thought it was a really great book. E.K. Johnston, I think it's a she, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I wasn't, you know, you don't want to assume, but also I know that most sci-fi writers that use their initials are women.
Yeah, as far as I know, E.K. Johnston is a she.
It does seem like they try to get female writers to write the books with their focusing on their female characters for the most part. But I think she is my second favorite EU writer. Claudia Gray is my favorite. I loved Ahsoka, and I did love this book quite a bit. And I liked Padme more as a character. Well, because I felt I got to know Padme more as a character in reading this. This is Padme without the romance bogging her down.
I will agree with almost every single thing you said, with one caveat. I think this was a phenomenal prologue to a Padme story.
That is fair.
I think I felt the entire book that it was building up to something that never happened.
That is actually fair. I do agree with that. And I would actually go farther in that I feel it's the prologue to two books. It is the prologue to a Padme book, and it is the prologue to a Sabé book.
Yes, I'd be good with that. I was going to say it's a great prologue to a trilogy, so same idea. But I loved everything about it, except that it felt rushed. And that's not the right word. It felt incomplete.
Yeah, I can see that. I almost feel like, she was writing a story and was building somewhere, and they're like, hey, EK, this is a kid's book. Like, you can't go on for too many pages.
Right. It's like the storyline with Sabé and the slavery could have been its own section of a book going on for two more books. The part about the assassination attempt and the droid when she met Bail Organa was basically dropped.
That is true.
That could have been an entire story right there.
That is true. I think I liked it for the character development. The plot itself was a bit thinner. Or not thinner, but...
No, I think the plot was great. I just feel like never got where it was going.
Yeah. But for the development of all of the characters, because it really was not just Padme, as mentioned, Sabe, who is the decoy handmaiden from mm-hmm. The Phantom Menace, played by Keira Knightley, she's basically the secondary protagonist in this. There is quite a bit with her, and I like getting to know her, too.
I like getting to know about all the handmaidens, actually.
Yeah, I mean, they're all... I liked getting to understanding how...
Why they followed Padme so intensely.
I feel like E.K. Johnston did a really good job assigning reason to stuff that George Lucas put in The Phantom Menace just because it was cool. Or he thought it was cool.
Yes, no, I fully agree with that.
Because, I mean, you had Padme in, like, these epic gowns that she's, like, changing in every single scene, and people for years have been like, why the heck was she doing that? Like, it just did not make any sense. And they actually take the time to explain it in this book, like, why there's such an elaborate dress on Naboo, and how it's actually basically armor, and how quickly they can get out of it, and, like, how the handmaiden and decoy system works. And I thought it was, this is going to sound bad, but I thought it was some pretty good bullshit.
No, I know what you mean, actually. I wouldn't call it pretty good bullshit, but it was pretty good expansion on unnecessary film details.
Yeah. I mean, I call it bullshit. It's like canon headcanon.
Okay.
Because obviously it was put in, this was not like the original intention of George Lucas. George Lucas was not thinking of reasons for any of this stuff to happen. He put it in because it's like, this will be cool.
Let's make it as big as we possibly can.
Yeah. And I know, like, he actually did speak about, like, why Padme was in these elaborate outfits in the prequel trilogy. And he said, because I didn't have the chance to do that with the originals, because the characters were supposed to be at war. But this is, like, at the height of the Republic, so people are going to be dressed all fancy. It's not a world at war. So that was kind of, he was thinking about it from more of an outsider's perspective.
Okay.
And E.K. Johnston actually put in proper reasoning for it, as much as there can be. And I was reading it, and I was like, yeah, I can buy this, and this is an interesting idea. It makes me not only more interested in Padme, it makes me more interested in Naboo as a planet, as a culture.
Yeah, I would love to know more about Naboo as a culture.
As I was reading it, actually, I jumped onto Discord and was talking to our Star Wars group and was like, can anyone tell me, like, what's going on with Naboo now? Like, how are they reacting to, like, the First Order? How do people react to them post-Empire, considering what a part they had in the creation of the Empire? And, of course, nobody could give me an answer on any of that. But, like, that's the stuff that I started to get really interested in. And, like, for anybody who's reading my fanfic, they might be going to Naboo because of all of the thoughts that I've been having about Naboo.
Of course.
That's what happens with me. It's like, every time I read something, it's like, okay, now, like, since I've been reading this, I want to put this into my story. It's really awful. Thankfully, I already have Thrawn in my story, so I'm reading Thrawn Alliances, and it doesn't really make much of a difference on my story, because it's like, oh, well, he's already there.
The drawbacks of writing for an open canon.
Oh, yeah. Anyways, back to Padme.
And that right there could be a conversation about Padme, is that any conversation about her tends to go wandering off to the people around her and the events around her, rather than the woman herself.
That's, yeah.
And we didn't do that intentionally, I promise.
Yeah, no, it's really not, and I certainly do like her better as a character, being in her head a little bit more with Queen Shadow. She's still not, like, a top-tier character for me, but it's like, I can appreciate you, and I would like to know more about you. I also think you are way too good for your husband.
Most people would be.
Well, yeah. One thing I really enjoyed about this is that I don't even know if Anakin was named in this book. Like, certainly they talked about Shmi Skywalker, and there were allusions to Anakin. Like, they kind of danced around the fact that Padme is wearing the Jaipur snippet.
Do you remember the little boy when she goes into the restaurant? She passed a kid in a doorway or something like that?
I don't remember that bad.
It was a real, real brief moment. I'm pretty sure that was supposed to be Anakin.
Oh, really?
Yes. I wouldn't be able to tell you when it happened in the book, but...
Huh.
But I'm pretty sure that that's supposed to be him. Unnamed and unspecified.
Huh. Still, I did like that we were dealing with Padme as herself rather than as an extension of Anakin, which... Definitely in the prequels, and I think even in the Clone Wars, there were some good episodes that focused on Padme, but it always kind of boiled down to Padme and Anakin.
Right. I mean, Padme had her own storylines.
Yeah.
But it was always either helping Anakin or Anakin coming to her rescue or...
Yeah. Or there was always, how is Anakin going to react to what Padme is doing?
Right. So seeing her in Queen's Shadow by herself, well, not by herself, mm-hmm. but without him, it was refreshing.
Yes, refreshing. That's a very good word for it. One of my biggest, well, I don't want to call it a regret because it's not a regret because I didn't make them. But one of the things that I wish they had done with Revenge of the Sith is I wish that they included the subplot of Padme being involved with the nascent rebellion.
That was in the deleted scenes, right?
That was in the deleted scenes.
I have admittedly not seen the deleted scenes, but I have heard bits about them.
I should send you some of the fan edits that have been done of the last two movies. Because actually, The Phantom Menace is kind of, I don't try to bash on it too much, but The Phantom Menace is kind of beyond repair. There's not really much that you can do. But Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, there are actually... decent movies in there. It's just that the focus was wrong. And a lot of people have edited back in the development of the rebellion. And it actually makes Padme a much stronger character in Revenge of the Sith. Because basically all she's doing is, you know, housing the twins and the dying.
Right. Yeah, I mean, Padme was basically the main character of Phantom Menace. I see her as the main character.
Yeah, because, I mean, she is the one who's involved in every single step.
Yep. They have to go to Tatooine because she needs to get to Coruscant.
Yeah. And, I mean, like, Obi-Wan disappears for the length of a Bible, basically.
Yeah.
So, yeah, she is the one who's involved in everything, so...
And I think that's why the way Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith happened seems so discordant with Phantom Menace. Is because our main character kind of got shoved to the background.
Yeah, I've never really thought about that. That makes a lot of sense because the Phantom Menace does seem like an outlier in terms of the Skywalker Saga movies.
Yeah, the Skywalker is a secondary plot point.
Yeah.
I've realized in the past 20 years that I actually like Phantom Menace, so it's taken 20 years, but I've decided I do actually like it.
I have very conflicted feelings about it, and people can go back and listening to the Building a Better Prequel episode that we did a couple of years back at this point, and you can hear what my conflicted feelings are. I do enjoy them, but I can definitely see the flaws in them. I don't know, it might be time for me to go back and rewatch them. I had hoped to rewatch them to do this episode, but unfortunately I didn't have time for that. I wanted to rewatch a lot of stuff involving Padme to do this episode, but unfortunately time was not on my side.
I wanted to do the same, and I had the time, but for those who don't know, I just got LASIK last week, and I'm only just starting to be able to watch TV for any length of time. Rewatching movies just wasn't going to happen.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you know, that's when you're strictly in audiobook territory.
Yeah.
Or podcasts.
Yeah, didn't work for movies.
The creation of the Rebellion subplot that was cut out of Revenge of the Sith, I feel like all of the deleted scenes that happened in the prequels are actually still canon. It's just we didn't see them in the movie. Because certainly everything that happened in them have been referenced in other materials.
Okay, so as long as they're not explicitly contradicted, there's no reason not to think of them as canon.
Yeah.
Cool.
And this book specifically really addressed a lot of those deleted scenes, and that we did see Padme's family in this. They were introduced in a deleted scene in Attack of the Clones. And like the way the family unit is structured is the same in both of them. So I kind of take them as being, as it being canon. And in this book, she also does meet Bail Organa, and she meets Mon Mothma, and she starts to develop her connection with them. And that is a connection that will carry through them starting the rebellion. And if I remember correctly, I believe in Bloodline that it's mentioned that Padme was part of the early rebellion.
I think it was.
It sounds like something that happened.
If it's not, it should have.
Yeah.
And until someone tells me otherwise, it did.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, in Queen's Shadow, when she met Bail and Mon Mothma for the first time, I had to remind myself that the rebellion didn't start being formed that early. Because I thought that's where it was going. It's a natural progression from it.
I mean, how do I word this? I feel like it was starting to be formed, but just not actually formed.
I think...
if that makes any sense?
It does. I think we're basically saying the same thing.
Yeah.
But to me, it didn't feel like the building of a rebellion at that point. It was the making sure we all are on the same page of how the Republic should exist.
It's like if Revenge of the Sith is the conception of the rebellion, then this is the meet cute.
Okay. Yeah, I got that.
That's like one of the weirdest metaphors I've ever come up with.
No, but it makes sense. It does make sense.
I also enjoyed that it wasn't an immediate love between Bail and Mon Mothma and Padme. They don't immediately like get along with each other. We did have to like go on this journey of them getting to know each other and trusting each other.
Right, because when Padme called for the vote of no confidence back when she was still queen, the rest of the Senate didn't really trust her.
Yeah, and she's called a puppet queen in this. And, well, I mean, she was not a puppet queen.
Not intentionally.
But Palpatine did play her hardcore.
So she kind of was a puppet. She just didn't know it.
Yeah, which I guess is kind of, that's how puppets work.
So she was kind of the puppet queen. But only in that specific moment.
Yeah, it was a very specific thing, and Palpatine plays everybody. I mean, like, nobody plays the game better than Palpatine.
Yeah.
So I found this book interesting, also from a real-world perspective, because they do have these, like, news feeds, like, between chapters where they're talking about Padme, and the wording that they use to talk about her reminded me so much of what, like, your Fox News will be referring to your liberal female politicians. There's just this cadence that's just, like, attacking, but it's, like, this in this really patronizing way. And I thought it was really well done in that it did remind you of that, but it wasn't, like, beating you over the head with it. It's not like they had, like, a Donald Trump analog in there.
Yeah. Star Wars does a really, really good job of tying real-world politics in relatively subtle ways.
Yeah, I will, you know, unpopular opinion time. I really enjoy Star Wars politics.
No, me too.
I mean, like, this is probably one of the reasons why some of my favorite books are, like, Leia and Bloodline and now this one. These are all of their very heavy political books. I think the politics were handled a little better in these than in the prequels, but then I also think that it's a bit easier to get into political matters in a book than it is a sci-fi action movie that's supposed to, like, be aimed at kids.
Yeah, had the prequels been about politics and politics alone, they might have actually been really good.
Yeah.
Instead of trying to interweave it in with action-adventure and space battles, etc.
But I think they, with the books, they're doing a really good job of finding a good balance. I think at this point they've been dancing around the political books so much they need to just go balls out with a political thriller.
I think they're gonna get there.
They're getting close. Like, they're very, very close, but I just, like, Yeah, I think eventually they will, like, fully do that. And I think Padme, either Padme or Leia are the characters that they're going to have to do it with. Possibly both, because why not both?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just thinking of where Sabe was left at the end of Queen's Shadow.
Oh my gosh.
And that would be an interesting political book right there.
Yeah. I was actually, like, a tiny bit bummed that Bail contacted, like, okay, we're going to go into a few spoilers for the end of the book, but I was bummed that Bail contacted her and presumably was going to tell her something about, like, what happened to Padme. Because I kind of wanted Sabe to investigate it herself and find out everything. Though, I mean, I guess we didn't actually, like, see Bail, like, explain everything. So it's possible he didn't.
Yeah, no, I like it from either perspective.
Yeah.
Where she goes and finds out on her own, or Bail tells her. And she goes and uses that as inspiration to, you know, kick ass everywhere else.
I haven't looked this up, but I believe in the Legends continuity that Sabe went and became, like, Leia's nanny.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Let me actually just hit up Wikipedia very quickly.
That's what I was doing earlier today.
I think, like, we probably both just have, like, Wikipedia just, like, up whenever we do a podcast.
Basically, because... yeah. It's certainly up right now with a couple of different pages.
Okay. She did join the House of Organa, and she was employed as an envoy to establish resistance cells.
Okay. So how about we kind of tie that into canon? And can we have Sabe hook up with Ahsoka?
In what way?
Any way you want. And yes, I used that phrasing intentionally.
I know you did. Yeah, she was an envoy to the rebellion and she was tutor for Leia.
Okay.
Which I'm here for. I'm here for all of that. Because, I mean, Leia, like, certainly kicked ass. So, like, she had to, like, develop those skills somewhere. Let's develop them with Sabe.
Yes, she had to learn it from someone.
And yes, let's have her hook up with Ahsoka in whatever way people would like to have them hook up.
I'm good with that.
Yeah. We didn't get to see Sabe and Padme together a lot in the book because they were both doing their own separate things. But I loved the relationship between those two women.
Yes. Oh, God, yes.
It is. I'm hoping that there is a lot more femslash written about them because the closeness between them is as close as any of, like, the major slash fanfic, like your Kirk and Spock and your John and Sherlock's. They're that close. So I really would, you can, like, even Sabe's love interest, like, basically says, it's like, you're never gonna love me as much as you love Padme.
Right. It's Padme came first in her life.
Even after Padme dies, she's still number one in Sabe's life. Yeah, no, I want to read a lot more about those two together. Like, I mean, like, not together, together. Or maybe together, I don't know.
But just the two of them.
Just the two of them. Interacting, yeah. Because certainly that is also a thing with the Star Wars movies, that you always have, like, your one female character that is, you know, interacting with the boys, but they don't get any close female relationships. Mm-hmm. And this is, obviously, from this book, this is the most important relationship in Padme's life. Sabe is, everything is done in service to her queen. And even after she stops being queen, she is still Sabe's queen. And throughout everything that Padme is doing, she's always thinking, I wish Sabe were here.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I feel like there's, like, so much to say about, it's really strange that it's like, I didn't know how much that I was gonna have to say about Padme, but now I feel it's like, now that we're talking about it, it's like, it's very disjointed, but there actually is just a lot.
Yeah, there really is. I mean,
yeah,
I think her story was disjointed.
Yeah.
It makes sense that a conversation about her would be too.
Just moving away from Queen's Shadow for a bit, there was the Age of the Republic comic that came out, and certainly they must have timed it so that you know, Queen Shadow was coming out, so people were going to be interested in Padme. So let's also do a comic that focuses on her. This was my first introduction into the Age of Republic comics, but I've actually read some more of them now. I enjoy them. I think people should check them out. Well, I think people should check out all of the Star Wars comics.
Most of them.
most of them. Yeah.
The Age of Republic ones really are good, though, and they stand by themselves.
Not just stand as by themselves as, like, these are stories that take place during the Republic, but each of the comics stand on their own.
Yeah, they're basically a series of one-shots.
So this story is about Padme being a political figure and, you know, trying to make an alliance with a planet. Now this story is different than Queen Shadow in that there is, I think actually some of the most interesting stuff about this story is connected to Anakin.
Okay.
Specifically, I think the most interesting point that came out of this story is that Padme doesn't fully trust Anakin.
See, that's not how I read it. I read it more that she knows Anakin is way overprotective and would insist on either going with her or insist on her not going.
Well, she also has a line about Anakin's relationship with Palpatine.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, she says that Anakin is very close with Palpatine and she's not sure about him anymore. Not that she's not sure about Anakin, she's not sure about Palpatine.
Okay, I did miss that line.
There is this mistrust building, and we also get the handmaidens being. It's like, they are the worst secret marrieds ever.
Everyone knows they're married. It's the biggest open secret in the war.
I still think that Obi-Wan didn't know.
And I think he did.
They're really so bad at it. They were just kissing out in the open, and the handmaidens are like, yeah, we're good at discretion. You're not.
Right. No, because I'm positive that Ahsoka knew.
Oh, Ahsoka.
And if Ahsoka knew, then Obi-Wan knew. Because I can't see, we're now digressing to Ahsoka. I can't see Ahsoka not immediately going to Obi-Wan and going, how am I supposed to deal with this now?
That's very true. Now, one thing about, I mean, we do have to talk about Anakin and Padme's relationship a little bit if we're talking about Padme, because it is the most defining characteristic we have in terms of Padme. And one thing that I've been thinking about in all of the Clone Wars era things that I've been reading, I think that if the Clone Wars had ended and Padme and Anakin had not, like, died and become Darth Vader or whatever, if, like, the Clone Wars had just, like, definitively ended and they got to go on to lives that were outside of a war, I think they would have broken up.
I think Anakin would have left the Jedi for her and been miserable and broken up. I think she would have felt guilty and he would have hated everything and nothing would have changed.
See, I'm thinking that Anakin probably would have tried to leave and Padme would have been like, no, you can't leave. You've dedicated your life to this. And then kind of ghosted him out.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. It's just, in looking at the relationship, so much of it is based off this heated life or death.
Intense in the moment.
Yeah, they were never together when there was not a war going on. And so there's these two dumb kids who think that they're going to die at any moment. So they got into this passionate relationship, which is not a normal, they never got to be a normal couple. I mean, he was, like, sneaking into her apartment. They were not normal.
In defense of that, no one in Star Wars has normal relationships.
Yeah, nobody in Star Wars has good relationships either.
Not in general, no. But yeah, they had a very, I don't want to use the word intense again, but
it's an apt word.
Yeah. Everything was, oh, thank goodness we're not dead. Let's get married.
It's this whole heightened thing, and they did not spend a whole lot of time together, so I think
that without a war keeping them together, they wouldn't have stayed.
And honestly, Padme is way too good for him. Just flat out.
Yeah, no, I don't disagree with that in the slightest.
And I mean, I say that as someone who likes Anakin. For what he is. I like Anakin for what he is, but still, Padme's way too good for him. I think that Padme is, I mean, I think this is one of the reasons why she's such an enigma. They've put her on this pedestal where she is like this she's always giving herself into things that are larger than herself. And she's this tragic figure who dies and, you know, is this, you know, this beloved... She's the lost Lenore for Darth Vader. And so they didn't really want to dig too deep into her, because if you dig too deep into her, you make her human, you give her more flaws. And basically her only flaw is the fact that she fell in love with this dumbass.
Yeah, you're kind of seeing, I'm realizing, we're seeing Padme from Anakin's perspective.
Definitely, yeah.
Where he sees her as perfect, and so we see her as perfect.
And I think with Queen's Shadow that we do kind of take away those layers, because this is kind of Padme unfiltered.
Well, it's Padme filtered, but it's not Padme filtered by Anakin.
Well, yeah. It is more like we get to see her actually acting and emoting.
And being an individual.
And we get to see, like, her connections with different people. We see that her handmaidens, that they were not just servants to her, that they were kind of the only people that she was actually able to be herself with, and her, well, I guess her family as well.
I think she was more herself with her handmaidens than with the family.
That is true.
It's the same as any of us being more ourselves with our friends.
And certainly, her family is odd. Padme became the queen of a whole planet, and her mother still wished that she had become an artist instead.
So it's a mother. Yeah, parents are never going to be happy, even if you're queen.
They do really establish in this that Padme's never had the chance to be anything other than Padme Amidala, Queen of Naboo, and then Padme Amidala, Senator from Naboo. And I think that is part of what contributes to her relationship with Anakin. That, and I believe it was Emma talked about this in the prequel episode, that these are two sheltered kids who just don't know how to function as normal people because they've been thrust into these positions that young people really aren't ready for. And that's why they fall into this incredibly immature relationship, because they've been so used to servicing everyone else that they haven't really developed their own selves.
Yeah, no, I like that. Well, I see that.
Yeah. You don't like it because it's, you know. Because
it's not something to like, but I definitely see that. So we should probably at some point talk about Padme's death. I think we're both kind of avoiding it, but.
Yeah.
It is a thing that should be touched on, at least.
It is one of the defining characteristics of her character, is the fact that she died. Unfortunately, like, that was the only thing we knew about her going in. It's like, yeah, she gonna die.
Right. There was no choice in it.
So
canon states that she died of a broken heart. I disagree. How about you?
I want to disagree.
I think that Palpatine had the power to kill from a distance, and he did.
I've heard that. I think the theory that I heard was that Palpatine drained the energy out of Padme and, like, funneled it into Anakin to help him, like, recover from his injuries.
I have heard that one. I don't like it. I prefer the idea that he killed her to make sure that Vader was his.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I definitely think that Padme wasn't getting out alive as far as the Emperor.
But she was way too strong of a person to die of a broken heart.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I mean, I cannot believe that a woman as strong as Padme, and Padme is strong no matter how the prequels could portray her at times. She was a very strong character, and I refuse to believe that a woman who just gave birth to two children is going to lose the will to live. Because, like, throughout Revenge of the Sith, that's the only thing she was concerned about was the kids. Because, like, when Anakin has the dream about her dying in childbirth, she's like, well, was the child okay? So she's not just going to lose the will to live because Anakin has gone to the dark side. There's got to be other things involved. I do believe that since George is no longer in charge of Star Wars, that they're trying to change that canon a little bit, because I mean, certainly in the movie that they say that she died of a broken heart, but they have introduced things where it's like, oh, well, the droid didn't know what it was talking about. Anakin was choking her, and so, yeah, no, she didn't die of a broken heart. That was just, is it Robot Chicken did a short, it was Dr. Ball, the droid ball from Star Wars, and when the, and it's, in, and he like goes through Star Wars scenes and makes diagnoses, and during the part when Padme's like, you know, she lost the will to live, that Dr. Ball is like, what is your degree in poetry?
I haven't seen that. That's funny, though.
Oh, I'll get you a copy of the Robot Chicken Star Wars specials. Cool. They're awesome.
Awesome, awesome.
Yeah, so, yeah, no, we're both definitely on the side of not dying of a broken heart. I think it's death by plot more than anything else.
Well, it's definitely death by plot, but I can justify the plot. Or justify the death for the plot. That's what I was trying to say.
One day, I'm going to write the Padme fanfic that is in my head. I think I've already mentioned it on the podcast, but I basically have a pretty epic fanfic in my head where Padme survives and actually becomes Boba Fett.
There's no reason not to.
Well, in my mind, it's the only way I'll like Boba Fett.
Okay. Okay. You have fun with that headcanon there.
Oh, come on. I wrote a slash fic with Vader and Tarkin. There is no level I can go to now.
I didn't say otherwise. Oh, boy.
So I think we should probably give our final thoughts on Padme.
Okay. I think I like her more than I did an hour ago. She's still not one of my favorite characters, but I am looking forward to finding out more about her.
I couldn't have said it better myself. That is exactly what I was going to say. It's, wow, this is a really interesting character that was made 20 years ago, but is now becoming somebody that I'm really interested in knowing more about. And I think we probably will get more about her. I mean, obviously, we're getting more Clone Wars episodes, though I don't know how much she's going to be in them. But I think right now, the prequel era is safe for them to explore because they're still not sure what they want to reveal about the post-Empire world. So they can do stuff in during the Clone Wars. And I guess now with the 20th anniversary of The Phantom Menace, this is like a good time for them to start revisiting that sort of thing.
It's the perfect time.
So yeah, I'd like to see more of her. And yeah, I think I like her more after this discussion. Definitely, she's not a top tier character for me, but she's somebody that I want to like more. So, and I think that's a good place to leave that character.
I completely agree.
So I think that wraps up this month's conversation. We'll be back next month with Celebration, actually.
Yay!
Yay! Yes, all of the money going far, far away from me now.
And we'll figure out how we're covering it at some point. It'll be a surprise to us and you.
Yeah. So until then, may the Force be with you.
Always.